Australian dryland rivers, they're alive and kicking. I'm really passionate about them. Landscape processes underpin everything that we do. So whether it's engineering practices and standards or land use planning or anything right down to the goals that we enshrine in legislation and the language that we use to write that legislation, all of that, if it's in any way involved in landscapes or catchments, we need to know about the landscape processes. The rivers of the Australian drylands are places that are rivers that are in moisture-limited locations. They are usually dry or not flowing. And when they do have a flow event, they're transient flow events. So the channel typically will go from dry to beginning to a big peak or several big flood peaks and then die away to nothing. So a transient flow event. So the catchments can be anything from tiny to huge. The gradient is usually very low gradient, but sometimes can be quite steep and sometimes can be backwards. And the sediment load can be anything from zero to absolutely lots. They're dry. Do they even work? Maybe they're just, you know, like normal rivers, but completely inert. So, yeah, dryland rivers work. They work all the time. Even when they're dry, they're working. Here we've got Cooper Creek. This is one of the narrowest places that the Cooper floodplain gets, and it's about 6 kilometres across and has a whole plethora of fluvial landforms. Drylands fluvial systems are complex. They are also really valuable. This is the Fink floodout complex, where the Fink River comes down and floods out into the Simpson Desert. Now, everything that you see that's red on there is inorganic, either sediment like dune fields or rock like gibberplane or silcrete. So the red stuff is inorganic. Everything that's black or grey is plant community. So even though in the Fink floodout complex there is not much in the way of channels or big deep flows or anything like this, but buckets of water comes down here and supports terrestrial ecosystems way out in two directions into the Simpson Desert, as you can see there. The state of being in dry country actually changes some of the things that are really important to how rivers work. So the timing and the location of rain is obviously highly variable and uncertain. Also, the intensity is very variable and uncertain. When the rain falls on a hill slope, it is not, as it is in the temperate zone, sucked into the soil and then gets into the river, mediated by the soil processes. It hits the ground and is shed by the ground surface. So it comes as surface runoff, Hortonian runoff. The hill slope that the rain is falling on also has a very varied characteristic of its runoff coefficient. There's also variable throughput. So as a flow event travels down the river's drainage network, the volume of water carried by the river after a certain point, the volume of water starts getting smaller and smaller and smaller as water is abstracted into the channel bed or the banks or taken up by the trees or whatever. So the throughput is variable, and then it's made even more variable because the patchy distribution of vegetation means that evapotranspiration is also kind of patchily distributed in the landscape. Finally, and this is another great big story, the nature of aridity changes the vegetation landform spatial relationships in a way that influences things like bioengineering, and that has implications for landform and landscape evolution, and there's a whole bunch of things happening there. As a continent, we have very low relief. We have subtle but significant neotectonism. All across the continent, there are places where there has been folding or faulting or warping sufficiently recent that it still has an influence on the landscapes that we see today, and that means it influences things about our rivers. This is a really important one. We have deep regolith. So the regolith is everything that isn't either fresh air or fresh rock. Some of the regolith has got really high runoff coefficients. So if you imagine rain falling on things like silkreet or gibber plain, or these pale weathering profiles that you see here, the rain is just shed off that kind of regolith like anything. Whereas the photograph on the right, those are cracking clay soils from the Thompson River. So this stuff is just like a ginormous sponge. It has to be really, really, really wet before it sheds any rain at all. Because of where we are on the globe and because of our topography, we are a largely moisture-limited continent, but nonetheless, when a big weather event happens, it can sweep far enough inland so that we get big dumps of rain or big flows of water into the inland. All this context means that we are actually, in some ways, dissimilar to some of the other dry lands that people know best. The west of the United States and the Middle East are places where some of the foundational literature in geomorphology and dryland sedimentology has been written in these places. This means that ideas from other dry lands don't necessarily apply here. Australian dryland rivers have so many special characters, and I can't talk about all of them. I have to talk about one. This is like being asked to pick a favourite child. So I'm just going to talk about highly variable flow regimes and what that means for channels and flow paths. But there is all this other stuff as well, right? The channel is usually described as the main pathway of water flow. It's a continuous and defined path. In fact, that is enshrined in Australian legislation in some places. And the channel is created by the active flow of the water. The floodplain is defined by the ISC as the low area that flanks the stream and gets flooded every couple of years. There is often a connotation of the floodplain being a flood basin or an area of overflow drainage where the water comes out and then goes back into the proper river again. Floodplains are where people live and work. So the things that we tend to measure on floodplains tend to be things like flood risk. If we live near a low variability perennial river, we've got reliable in-channel water and we've got an accessible floodplain. Whereas if we live near a drylands river, we can expect to have a dry channel a whole lot of the time, but we can also expect widespread inundation. So in highly variable rivers, obviously channels are a type of flow and obviously they're important, but they are not the only type of flow and they're not the only important flow. In fact, channel is not even always a meaningful concept here. And the in-channel flow is not what uniquely defines the river. Floodplain level flow exists. It is a thing. It is also important. And it is part of the flow plan, the flow path that defines the river. Let's get this one out of the way quickly. I have had people say to me, flooding in a river is just a waste. We could be using that water. Flooding is not a waste, okay? Floodplain level flows are what drive the boom and bust ecosystems that are characteristic of the dry lands. This is a bunch of us getting together to watch the fish cross the road at the Algebuckana Causeway. It's not that the fish are migrating in the channels. They actually don't want to be in the channels. They get out of the channels and they migrate across the floodplain and go to a different flow path and go to a different channel in that river system. They're also equally important for the terrestrial ecosystems. But the other thing that I think that people don't truly appreciate is that flooding is important also for the physical aspects of the landscape. So widespread inundation is important in recharging groundwater in those places where the river recharges the groundwater. And the flow energy, when you get a flood that's big enough to inundate and flow across the floodplains, that flow energy is strong enough to maintain and renew the physical habitat. So particularly the primary and secondary channels and the water holes absolutely depend on high energy flows to maintain their depth. I think it's fair to say that sustainable land and catchment management has absolutely got to rest on a true understanding of landscape processes. If we're just making stuff up, we're not in a good position to make good decisions about managing the landscape. Inland Australian landscapes deserve the same care that we give to other places. Finally, in a future where extreme climate events are likely to occur, I think we're likely to get more highly variable rivers, and I think it would be good if we could act with a greater understanding of those conditions. Thank you so much for coming out tonight.